Hello, my name is Reinert Nijland and I'm from the Marine Animal Ecology Group of Wageningen University in the Netherlands. And today I'd like to talk about how we study the biodiversity of the North Sea using DNA sequencing. The North Sea is a rather small sea in the north of Europe. And for you that don't really immediately know it on the map, this is where you can find the North Sea. As you can see from this overview of the Earth, it's a really, really shallow part of the sea. It's not very deep. Most of the half of the North Sea is less than 50 meters deep. If we zoom in a little bit more, you can see it's surrounded by countries, the UK, Belgium, the Netherlands, Germany, Denmark, Sweden, and Norway. And as you probably are well aware of, these are very busy European countries, so the North Sea is also a very, very busy sea. There's a lot of shipping, there's oil and gas drilling, there's also a lot of fishing going on, and all this together has led to the ecosystem of the North Sea being pretty degraded. For instance, if you look at this map, you can see here fishing intensity for bottom trawling per year. And everywhere on the map where it's orange or red, then the sea bottom is basically fished for multiple times a year. And this has led to a degradation of the ecosystem. And I'd like to say a little bit more about that ecosystem degradation. So in ecology, we have the concept of the trophic cascade, which means that there's a drop predator and it eats a lot of its prey, so the prey abundance goes down. Well, and this can cascades down all the trophic levels. So basically, if there's fewer prey animals, then the food source of the prey, so the zooplankton, it can increase because it's not being eaten. And then as a result, the algae that are normally eaten by the zooplankton are decreasing because they're heavily fed on. So this is this trophic cascade. And what happens if you take away the top predators is the prey species, they increase massively because they are suddenly relieved from their predation. So they will eat a lot of the zooplankton, which goes down. And then, of course, the food source of the zooplankton, so the algae, go up. Well, this can lead to, for instance, harmful algal blooms. But that's not only is not a problem. Another problem is that actually the larvae of the large predatory fish are also part of the zooplankton. So these predatory fish suddenly are being eaten by their former prey. And therefore they have a very hard time coming back. So if you want to restore the ecosystem, you need to find a way for these predators also and their young to survive, so maybe to hide somewhere. Well, this is what has been happening in the North Sea. And that's actually called fishing down the food web. So you have this image here of North Sea fish. You see large cod and sea bass. They've been caught by fishing. And then there's less predation on herring, for instance. And so the herrings, they increase. And they're more easy to catch as well. But this is, of course, not sustainable. But because in the end, if all the larger fish are caught, then there's only very small fish or jellyfish left over in the end. And that's, of course, not something we would like to see. And what is something else is illustrated here is the shifting baseline principles, because you might think that on the left of this image, you have a very nice complete ecosystem with all the large top predators, sharks, tunas, they're missing from this picture. So people would assume the left part of this image is a healthy ecosystem, whereas actually 100 years ago, it was completely different. For instance, if you look at these images of fishing markets around the North Sea of about 100 years ago, you see immense amounts of large cod, but you see also halibut that were over 2 meters long, and even bluefin tuna used to be rather abundant in the North Sea up until maybe the 1960s. So the shifting baseline principle is really happening here. There's a collective amnesia that surrounds the changes that happened more than a few decades ago. So people just don't remember how many of these huge predators would be swimming in the North Sea. And another example of this collective amnesia might be shown by Nanopore itself, actually, because a few years ago, we used to have the albacore bay scholar, which is a big tuna fish. And now we shifted to guppy. And I'm pretty sure many people actually don't remember albacore anymore. There's a light on the horizon, I would say, because we have now the bonito bay scholar, which seems to be doing better. So the ecosystem is slowly restoring. So how do we, or how do I envision that we can restore this ecosystem? Well, and this might be a surprise, but offshore wind farms can play a major role in that. So they can provide shelter, they can provide habitat for fish, because also these wind farms, they are closed for fishing. So there's no fishing activity there. But of course, they have to be constructed and managed correctly to have the most positive effect. And for that, monitoring is required. And then a lot of things can happen, because this is a map of the North Sea with all the currently already built and future planned offshore wind farms. And you can see it's a major part of the North Sea will be used for that, actually. In 2050, it's planned for up to more than 20% of the North Sea North Sea area to be wind farm. And then if you do something interesting with these monopiles, for instance, you have here this artist impression of how you could build some extra additions to these pylons to create more ecosystem, create more habitat, actually. This might have a positive effect. But of course, you need to monitor that to see if this is the best way to do it, how this habitat is actually used. Monitoring of biodiversity in the North Sea is classically done by either fishing or grabbing sediments, cores, or colleague of mine, Joop Kolen, is doing diving on a wind farm or on an oil rig to see what you can all find there and how what animals and plants are growing there. So he is basically collecting samples and then he sends them off to the lab where somebody with a dissection microscope and a lot of knowledge about all the specimens is identifying them. Well, this works, but of course, if you have many samples, then you need a lot of taxonomists. So it's not really scalable, and it's also rather expensive. So what you can do is you can replace the taxonomist by a blender and some DNA extraction work. And then you sequence the DNA from all the samples, and that will give you a picture of the biodiversity. And then maybe the diver can be replaced by using environmental DNA. And this is definitely not going to work for all types of samples, but for larger animals that swim in the water, for instance, fish, eDNA is a really suitable way of biomonitoring. So the DNA is present in the water column and it's originating from the skin or the mucus or the feces of all the animals that live in there. It's a very, very nice non-invasive method of monitoring, because you don't have to catch the animals. And it also allows to study a temporal scale, because the DNA is degrading over in a few hours or a few days after release. So if you sample, for instance, every week, you will get new samples. And what you do then next is you use metabarcoding to identify the biodiversity. So metabarcoding is used to identify species from a mixed community, and it's really similar to microbiome 16S rRNA gene analysis. You use PCR with universal primers to amplify a marker gene from the animals, and then you compare your sequence PCR product to the database. Well, there is then, of course, a choice to be made for which marker you want to use. Classically, in metabarcoding, a mitochondrial cytochrome oxidase, one gene is used. There's a big database of all these of this marker present. There's a good set of universal primers present. However, These primers are far too universal to, if you want only to study fish. So in eDNA samples, you mainly amplify algae, bacteria, and other things that you're not really interested in. So you cannot use these universal primers to study fish. There's an alternative gene on the mitochondrial DNA, the 16S. But also the universal primers currently available for that are not specific enough if you're only interested in fish. So for fish, you will need to use the mitochondrial 12S marker. However, this marker is very short and will give you a limited species resolution. But that's not a problem anymore if you use nanopore sequencing, because nanopore sequencing allows for the use of longer markers. So you don't have to use a very short fragment of like 300 or 600 nucleotides. You can go up to 2000 or even longer PCR fragments. If you want to know more about that, PhD student in my lab, Carlijn Doornspleet, has presented a spotlight talk in the metagenomics track about that, where she explained how she, together with Lara Janssen, another PhD student, has developed primers specific for fish with long fragments that allow to identify the fish all down to species level. So I already mentioned, the eDNA metabarcoding by nanopore sequencing is just, it's a great combination because it's fast, it's relatively affordable, you get long reads, you get real-time data access, and you can actually sequence on location. And to show that, I'll give you an example of what I've been doing myself. So we've done biodiversity assessment in the North Sea on the Borken Reef grounds. And here you see an artificial reef that was put down there at about 25 meters depth to stimulate biodiversity, but also to study the effect of this artificial reef. Well, as you can see, it's pretty biodiverse. So we went down there scuba diving, we collected water samples, take these water samples back up to the surface, and then on board of the ship, you filter the DNA from the water. And of course, that generates quite a lot of attention. Then if you have filtered the DNA, you extract it from the filter, you do a PCR to amplify your amplicon of choice, and then sequence that on a MinION flow cell or on a flongal or whatever you have available at that moment. We don't only sequence in the North Sea. There's another PhD student in our lab, Lucas Muller, and he studies bull sharks in Mozambique. And here you see him on a small dinghy filtering the eDNA from water samples that he was just taking on the reef below him. Of course, nanopore sequencing still is not delivering 100% accurate reads, which is often perceived as an issue when you want to do metabarcoding, because you're looking for 1 or 2 or maybe 3% differences in sequence if you want to separate species. However, if you have improved base calling, it generally does not result in better classification. Actually, raw read accuracy of 85% or higher most of the times is sufficient for proper classification of the species. Still, of course, a 100% accurate consensus sequence is always nicer because it allows to study for instance, haplotype diversity, etc. Well, in order to get that from our animal metabarcoding, Saskia Oosterbroek, a PhD student in our lab, she developed a script, it's called Decona, which allows you to demultiplex, then generate then cluster, and then generate a consensus out of these nanopore amplicon data. If you want to know more about that, she's presenting a poster here, and also the script is available through GitHub. So the major bottleneck at the moment is really the DNA reference databases. For many species, not enough genetic information is present in the reference databases, and it's very, very difficult to identify these species. So I'm involved in a European Interact project that is trying to solve this, at least partially, by both developing new methods for studying, for using DNA to study biodiversity, but also sequencing a lot of animals from the North Sea to get these reference databases more complete. And then, of course, preferably we'll sequence not only the short CO1 fragments, but also a larger part of the mitogenome, or maybe even the full genome for some animals. So DNA biomonitoring, it can not only be used to analyze sequencing, analyze environmental DNA, and you can also use that to analyze, for instance, the diet of fish species. This diet is often very much degraded, so very difficult to recognize, but the DNA still can be recovered. So if you recover DNA from the stomach content or even from the feces, you can nicely study diet. You get a lot of host DNA as well with that, but you can design PCR blocking primers that block amplification of the host DNA, and that works really, really well. So I've been talking now about what is possible already, but I'd also like to look a little bit more at future developments. So at the moment, I think the technology is there, but it's not being applied yet, but autonomous sampling of eDNA. So sample at certain locations that you're very much interested in, so artificial reefs, but also sluices, or maybe power cables, offshore power cables, and set make a device that can sample this eDNA for you at certain set intervals, so you can then analyze it later. More advanced would, of course, be to couple that in the field with DNA sequencing. You want to have a device that not only collects the DNA, but that also sequences it. So it needs to isolate the DNA, it needs to prep it, and it needs to sequence it and then send the data to a lab through, for instance, a satellite connection. Well, I think this is not possible yet, but last year Clive was talking about the MinEye in Mark II, which is really, really small, so much more easy to integrate in a device that has to be standalone. And if it has the sample prep already embedded, then it becomes even more easy. So I think this something like this could be developed in the next few years. Oh, here you have two of my colleagues, Niels and Erwin, who are tagging a hound shark with a satellite data storage pop-up tag. And as you can see and appreciate maybe, that this tag is larger than the MinEye. So you can definitely attach sensor devices to larger marine animals that width of a certain size. Well, I think it would be really nice if we can develop a DNA sensor that can initially be developed, deployed on underwater drones, but maybe if that's been established as also on larger fish or marine mammals. This can then be used not only to monitor the movement and the habitat, because that's what these satellite data storage tags do at the moment, but also sequence the DNA they encounter, so you can study other fish present in the environment and maybe even prey that is being consumed. And then for fish, you want to have a data satellite pop-up tag that pops up to the surface and then sends the data. But for mammals, which actually have to come to the surface to breathe, you can use this direct satellite uplink. Or alternatively, you can build lots of receiver stations that can then underwater communicate with the sensors. So one thing I didn't mention is that I think it might be hard to use PCR underwater or in a in-field device that is standalone. So I really, really like to skip the PCR step. That is a major bottleneck, because for eDNA, less than 0.1% of the DNA that you can actually collect from the environment is the DNA of the fish that you're interested in. The rest is microbial or algae or whatever. And of that, at the moment, less than 1% or 0.1% is present in the database, because for most species, we only have these short marker genes present. So we need a thousand to a million times higher throughput or sensitivity or selective sequencing to allow for this increase in sensitivity to make it possible. Nevertheless, I think this will be definitely possible in the next few years. And I think within 10 years from now, we could have see something like this with an online real-time diet analysis by in situ sequencing of the eDNA. So you have this seal here with a small sequencer on its back, and the sensors in this sequencer, they detect feeding behavior, then they will collect a little bit of DNA from the water, sequence it, and then identify the food source of this seal. And as soon as the seal surfaces to breathe again, it will send it through a satellite uplink, and we know that this seal just had been eating herring. Well, that's what I wanted to share with you. I have to thank some people that made all this work possible. And of course, I'd like to thank you for paying attention. Thank you.